In 1943, General Marshall, who was then Chief of Staff of the Army, decided that soldiers ought to be told why they were fighting, why they were drafted. Because at that time, America was a very different country than it is now. Specifically, for example, during in the approximate period of World War II, it's hard to believe now, but one out of every four Americans lived on a farm. There was a provincialism. At that time, I remember being surprised coming from New York and finding myself drafted into the Army. After a while, I got so I could tell the difference of speech from somebody from Mississippi as opposed to Georgia or Alabama. That's how provincial America was in those days. And so I was transferred into the Information and Education Program, and the assignment I was given was I was sent out to, first it was Lincoln Air Force Base in Nebraska, which was where all the crews were assembled to go to Europe with the planes came from the factories, the crews came from various schools and so on. And my job was once a week, every person on that base was to get a 10-minute summary of the news. Now, I should explain that during World War II, there were no portable radios. There was no such thing as a small radio. And we were so isolated from the civilian population, not by desire or connivance, but just by reality of training for war, that we never saw a newspaper. We didn't know what was going on. And so they put in for me in this little small office at the Lincoln Air Force Base, an Associated Press ticker, and I knew I was sent to a special school for a week to give it an idea what the Army wanted to emphasize in the news, such as, for instance, cooperation among the Allies, that this wasn't all American, and so on and so on. And I was to prepare a 10-minute newscast and to read it through or give it through loudspeakers to soldiers out during their 10-minute break away from marksmanship or whatever it was they were learning at the time. And when I started telling them what was going on in the war, and in 1942 or 3, I'm vague about my dates, I'm sorry for the memory, but the big battle of that time was at Stalingrad in the Soviet Union. Well, I discovered pretty soon that these soldiers who I was with didn't know where Russia was, didn't know anything about how the distances or the geography. They had never been away from home. None of us had been away from home for the most part, and it was absolutely not understandable to them. So I got assigned to me a young soldier who had been a sign painter in civilian life. And he started painting maps for me that were big enough that a couple of hundred soldiers sitting on the ground during their 10-minute rest break could see. And I soon discovered the maps didn't mean anything because they didn't know where they were in relation to where I was showing them where Russia was or where Europe was. And so gradually I experimented and I would say, now this is the Atlantic Ocean and this is Europe and so on. And over a period of time, I began to learn a great deal of what it was necessary to show a simplified map and geography that was understandable to these folks who had never been away from home before. Well, that was one of the lessons of my life, was that you never know when you learn something how years later, completely unpredictably, it's going to have a practical value. I went to work at CBS, and why did I get hired there? Back, because there's a long story which I'm omitting. My wife, incidentally, gave me one caution for tonight. The reason I got hired, because television was just being set up. It was being set up in Grand Central Station, and that's where the first television facilities were to be set up. And why was I hired? Because they had the same problem in a different way that I had dealt with as a soldier in the Army, which was this. In 1946, in March of 1946, the television sets that were just coming on the market had a screen 3 by 5 inches in size. That was the size. They were black and white. And there was no way in the world that a map, which they were using, taking out of an atlas or something, when you put it on a 3 by 5 inch screen, could be made out by anybody. Nobody could make out the detail. The The sets weren't very clear. There were only a few sets anyway. And so my map experience back in the Army led me to the problem of how could we figure out maps that would be simple enough to be understood on the simple little television screen of the period. Well, after I got hired, and we were setting up this television news operation, I decided I ought to have a television set at home. $200, and it was a big wooden box made out of war surplus parts, and somebody had gotten a cathode ray tube, and so on. The problems we had at television in those days were something that I think could only be understood, my friends, if we think of what the culture of news media was in 1946, or even before that. When it came to visual media, as opposed to the written word, when it came to pictures, there were two sources of visual media in the United States at that time. If it was motion pictures, it was the newsreels. A newsreel was a 10-minute, always 10-minute reel, that's what that one reel of film, 10 minutes long, that was shown in motion picture theaters between features, and the reason was to clean out the audience so that a new audience would come in for the next picture. And the problem that the newsreels had was that in those days, the equipment was so big and so heavy, there was absolutely no mobility at all. You couldn't move it around. So the result was that if you wanted to photograph something for a newsreel coverage, you had to use a big tripod. The film was 35 millimeter film, motion picture cameras, 35 millimeter motion picture cameras. Only things that newsreels could cover in those days was static events, but there was no such thing as improvisation because physically it wasn't possible. Now, if you went to still pictures at that period, there were the picture magazines, and those picture magazines essentially were two, Look magazine and Life magazine. Life magazine came out in November of 1936, and all through the war years, it was absolutely a dominating and wonderful news medium in the United States. Almost everybody in journalism has forgotten is why Life was so successful. It's hard to believe, my friends, but in the fall of 1936, the month that the Life magazine first appeared, the New York Times discontinued publication of a weekly picture magazine they had called Midweek Pictorial. Midweek Pictorial was the best picture source of news pictures in the United States at that time. The New York Times published it once a week in what, I guess you don't know what the word means, rotogravure, a very rich, dark brown coloring. So why did the New York Times fail with the Midweek Pictorial almost at the very same time that Life magazine opened on November 23rd, 1936? And the answer is, it sounds hard to believe, but it's true. Life magazine was the first one that ever got the idea of telling a story in pictures. Up until Life magazine, nobody had ever put a series of pictures together from beginning to end to tell a whole story. So those were the media that we were dealing with at that time when television was about to begin. The question that we faced, how we were going to tell the news on television, was complicated by the same factors that had inhibited and eventually destroyed the newsreels, and that was technology. Let me give you an idea what the technology of television was when we started in 1946. First of all, the cameras were very, very big. They were this big, each camera. I think CBS, as I recall, we had six of them in the whole CBS network. And the whole television network, I think we had six cameras. There were 3,000 television sets in New York. But we didn't really know whether they were that many because that was how many had been sold before World War II and how many of them still worked with nobody really knew. We were experimenting on this one night a week broadcast. And in this particular occasion, the Duke and Duchess of Windsor were the celebrities that I had brought up to the deck. And the Duke, for those of you who hadn't come across this, the Duke of Windsor was King Edward VIII of England, who had abdicated the throne of England, given up the throne. They had come to America. They really did nothing very much, and it probably the articles that say that the king was not very bright and was a Nazi sympathizer are probably close to the truth. In any case, it was a very important story for me, and here I was getting this for CBS television. And just as they were about to start the cameras, accidentally on purpose, one of the newsreel cameramen tripped and pulled our cord out, knocked the camera over, and we didn't get the interview. Because there was, in the early days of television, a tremendous anger on the part of the newsreel cameramen. They didn't like it one bit. The issue between the newsreels, and which were very important in those days because they had a mass audience and we had a few thousand people in New York watching us, the issue between us was that the cameramen from the newsreels all came out of the Hollywood movie industry. And they were all members of a union called the IATSE, International Alliance of Theatrical and Stage Employees, Local 659. And our television cameramen came out of the broadcasting industry, and they were members of the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 1212. And as far as the Hollywood men were concerned, that wasn't a union at all. And as far as the broadcast men were concerned, who were these Hollywood people to be interfering with them? So there was tremendous competition and nastiness and attempt to fight each other and so on, and it happened repeatedly. Well, in this case, after the Duke and Duchess had given their interview for television, or their statement for television, I had the job of going up to the Duke and asking him, would he please go out on the deck and let us do it, because we had had some technical problems. And he and the Duchess did, even though it was out in the rain. They were very nice about it. This was written up in the papers at the time, I should tell you. And my interview was silent because we didn't have any sound equipment out there on the deck. But I wrote up what he had to say, which was, I'm sure, not very consequential. And that's how we got it on television that night. But the problem of security for the President of the United States was not what it is now. And in 1950, whenever President Truman came to New York, I used to go out and cover him for CBS. And I knew him superficially. I mean, I'm sure he didn't even know who the hell I was. And he used to go for a walk in the morning. That was his habit, his morning constitutional. And usually he would be accompanied, as I recall, by a Secret Service man, one guy, walking up down Park Avenue. Well, I had been pressing the CBS engineering department to help us with the problem of covering sound, because we had no mobility of sound any more at that point than the newsreels did. And we were just struggling to find a way to have some mobility to report something with sound, the original sound as it happened. So they worked on it and worked on it and worked on it, and finally we decided we were ready to try it. So here's what happened. We mounted a 16 millimeter sound camera on the roof of a station wagon. And we had there was no such thing as wireless at that time. So we had an electric wire, maybe, I don't remember, 50, 75, 100 feet long, that went from the camera where the sound was being recorded onto a microphone, and a sound engineer was walking with the microphone in his hand. Now, if you know the location of the Waldorf Astoria, it's on the east side of Park Avenue. That's the side where the traffic goes northbound. We arranged to take, and the police were usually cooperative with us in those days, and we took the station wagon running against traffic, put it against the curb, as close to the curb as we could, and as the president came out walking from the Waldorf Astoria, the camera car was running along in the street next to him. The sound engineer was walking ahead of the president, maybe 10 feet ahead of him, 6 feet ahead of him, I don't remember, holding a microphone out. I had explained to the president what we were doing. And nobody had ever done this before. There was no other cameraman there. There was no other network there. There was no other reporter there. The president wasn't covered like he is today. And that night when we went on the air with the news, you saw a picture of President Truman walking down Park Avenue, and people would say to him, "Hello, Mr. President." And he would say, "Hello, good morning." And that was the essence of all the dialect. But it had never happened before. Nothing had ever been done before like that, where we had mobile sound. And the thing no sooner went on the air than we started getting phone calls from NBC asking, how did we do it? How did we manage to do it? Nobody had done that at that time before. So that gives you a picture of what it was like. President Truman went on a campaign train on behalf of Adlai Stevenson, who was running for president then, and I was on the train. And Lauren Bacall was on the train, and I remember traveling with her. We got well acquainted, and of course, television was such a curiosity in those days. You can't imagine how unusual it was for somebody to meet somebody from television. The source of our celebrities, as we considered them in those days, were people like Henry Luce, the owner of Time Magazine, the creator of Time Magazine, Father Flanagan of Boys Town out in Nebraska, Andrei Vyshinsky, who was Stalin's prosecutor in the Moscow show trials, people like that, and we had that regularly. The real problem, you see, that we were grappling with, however, was to try to make news a serious medium on television. And the things that we were really paying most attention to were, how do you tell a story? How do you tell a story on television news in 1 or 2 minutes? Something like a farm bill that's coming up in Congress. And you could have, for instance, farm scenes, maybe, but that's just pictures. That doesn't really add a dimension to telling the story. And we had a distinguished artist. I should mention him because he's one of the unknown figures of television, a man named George Olden, O-L-D-E-N, who's absolutely forgotten today, but was the first art director of CBS Television News, and who was extraordinarily African-American and absolutely lost to history. But he was the one who worked with us closely in figuring out ways of telling the news through explanations, moving charts, and so on. But I'll tell you a story. We had a problem that in the technology of 1946 and 47, there was no way that on television we had found to show a moving arrow on a map. There was no way we could do it. We didn't know how to do it. So suppose you have a brilliantly illuminated map, and suppose through a prism or a mirror arrangement, you have a hand which is covered black gloves that moves a white arrow across this map. The camera will not pick up the black hand on superimposition. It will only show the map, and it will show the white arrow that's moving. So this was a wonderful invention. It was patented. It was called the Bretsikon. And I was assigned to be the one to move the arrow. So they said, well, you'll have to get a black glove, a long black glove. So they sent me to Bergdorf Goodman, to the ladies' department. And I will only tell you that I was a very mortified young man when I went to the ladies' glove department and I told them what I wanted. And they said, well, what size is it? And I said, well, it's for me. And finally, I got the black glove, and we were all ready to go on the air that night and show the movement of the arrow on the map for the first time it was ever done. And a union fight developed as follows. The Stagehands Union, which is the local one of the IATSE, said, he can't move that. This is a piece of stage equipment. That belongs to us under the contract. And the Electricians Union said, wait a minute. It's got electric light bulbs in there, and there's a reflecting device. That's an electrical device. That's not a stage piece of equipment, and this guy who isn't a member of the union can't do it. The result was that the equipment was never used. It was never used at all, and it was must have been several years later before a way was found to show a moving arrow, and that's really what happened. I had another case like that. I would like to claim credit that I think I'm one of the few living people now who really saw an atom bomb at Camp Mercury Proving Grounds. was the first time they had ever invited the media to allow us to cover an atom bomb test. And it was an extraordinary experience. We were 6 miles away from ground zero. There's a tower where this atom bomb was located. It was pitch darkness, it was pre-dawn. And so they said, well, if you didn't get glasses, just keep your eyes closed tight and turn your back toward the explosion. So I was one of the people that didn't get glasses. And I went to the AEC, the Atomic Energy Commission people, and I said, well, what exposure should we use? Because this was pre-dawn, it was black. And they said, well, we can't tell you that. That would be an indication of the size of the weapon. So we set up maybe half a dozen different cameras preset with different exposures, hoping that one or the other would be perfect. Well, what happened was the whole thing was over so fast, in a millisecond, thousandths of a second, it was all over. Those pictures that you see were made with special scientific cameras that were shooting 3,000 frames a second, slowing it down so it could be studied. Well, I had at that time my hobby, this had nothing to do with my work. At that time, my hobby was three-dimensional photography, stereo photography. And I had a little stereoscopic camera, which I had brought along, and I had on a little tripod pointed in the direction of this tower when they did the countdown. And I knew that it would take a couple of seconds of human delay, my brain to work. So when they got to maybe, I don't know, 2, 1, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, whatever it was, I pressed the button on my own camera while the all of our CBS cameras were running already. And in those days, the scientific instrumentation wasn't as accurate or developed as it is now. So one of the measurements that they used was that 10 seconds before the blast, they shot up 10 smoke rockets parallel to each other at a certain distance apart, so that when the cameras photographed it with these high speeds, they could show as the blast hit the smoke, they could see how fast it was moving and so on. Well, it was complete luck. You couldn't possibly determine what you were going to get. When I pressed my button, I got and the pictures eventually came back. It was a remarkable shot. I think only one or two of the smoke things were bent and the rest were still parallel. That picture is in the collection of the New York Public Library, and I don't think anybody has ever discovered it to this day, but it's sitting there.